Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaint." And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared to them in a cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses. He said, "I have heard the complaint of the Israelites. Say to them, at twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God." In the evening, quails came and covered the camp. And in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there, on the surface of the wilderness, was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" But they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat. This is the word of the Lord."
I remember in the testimony last week, Miranda saying that as a young Chinese girl in communist China, she heard about Jesus, and she knew that there was something to do with the Bible, and she wanted to find Jesus in the Bible. And when she read the Old Testament, it just was confusing, and she gave up. It's too difficult. Of course, we know that the story of Jesus is in the Gospels and the New Testament. But actually, all of the Old Testament is filled with metaphors and images that point us to Jesus. And one of them is this metaphor of the manna, the bread from heaven, that Jesus is the bread who comes down from heaven. It's part of his messianic identity that he fulfills all of these Old Testament images, not only the specific prophecies like where he would be born, and where he would live, and how he would grow up, and how he would be a prophet and a sacrifice, and he would be betrayed, and he would die and rise again, not only the specific prophecies, but also the metaphors about him, that he would fulfill them. So Jesus was also the manna from heaven, he's the bread of life. And one of the amazing things of the Bible is that it's written over 1,500 years, and yet it has this cohesive unity, that all of the stories point towards the coming Messiah. All of the stories have something in them that tells you something about Jesus. Well, we're going to turn the bulletin now to the Psalm, which is Psalms of the Old Testament. And today we have a portion of Psalm 78. And I invite you to join with me. I'm going to suggest that we say it, men and women, by alternate verses, beginning with the men. We have few men these days, so I don't know what men are, but so men, if you hear, please, a voice, please speak out with a good voice as we say the old verses together. The general begins, we say, "So he commanded the clouds above, and
Once the people, now God's people, proclaim
beginning at verse 24. Glory to you, Lord Christ. On the next day, when the people who remained after the feeding of the 5,000 saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. Do you remember what happened last week? What was the gospel last week? We had the feeding of the 5,000. Remember that? They all got free McDonald's lunch. It was a fish fillet filled with fish. They got a fish burger for lunch. And they liked it. It was pretty good. So they wanted more. So they wanted to follow the guy with the fish fillets. Okay? So let me read it again. The next day, when people who remained after the feeding of the 5,000 saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, so the man with the fish fillets had gone, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. And when they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" And Jesus answered them, "Very surely I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal, that is the Holy Spirit." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very surely I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven. It is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." And they said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is the gospel of the Lord.
People who are either coming for the full program or who are coming for one day.
In fact, there are 87 full cabinets, the equivalent of 87 full cabinets. But I'm not very good at mathematics. It was my worst subject in school. And when the hotel asked us, how many will you commit to, I looked at the last cabin. And the last cabin, we had about 80 adults and 35 kids. So I said, oh, we'll commit to 80 adult packages and 35 kids packages. And what didn't dawn on me was that not all of those are full packages, that 20 or more of them were on this Sunday lunch people. So it means that we've actually overbooked, and we have to pay in advance. So we've paid and overpaid. Now, we've had a word with the hotel, and they're very kind, and they said they will negotiate it. They will cut it back, so they're maybe not going to charge us for the overbooking. So hopefully that will work out. They seem not too stressed about that. However, it does mean that we have 30 day packages for adults and children, which are currently going begging. So if you're still contemplating coming on camp, but you're worried about cost, please don't worry. Sign up, because we've already paid. And we have a number of places that are there. Of course, if you don't sign up, the hotel may reimburse us, but we would really like you to sign up and to come, that would be the best thing. So please do sign up today at the welcome table here after church if you have not signed up for camp, and sadly don't leave me in charge of calculating numbers for camp next time. So I've put the photos back up to the spine.
Songs for camp.
Getting ready, please pray for Ian and the youth band. Actually, today, Mia's family is not well. Her mum was in hospital last night, and she's, I think, Nico is sick as well. So I'm sure they appreciate the grand family. You know, the girls choreographed a wonderful dance last week. I'm sure they would appreciate your prayers for their family. They seem to have a bucket or something with fever that's going on at the moment. So I just commit those things to you. I think those are the main things. Please have a look at the bulletin. Yeah, those are the main things I wanted to mention. Please have a look at the bulletin. Thank you very much. All right, if you have any questions about camp, you can message Miss Lucy. Miss Lucy's in quarantine. She gets out the day before camp, so she will be with us on camp. She and Kevin are in quarantine. They went to a wedding in Hong Kong. So you can send her a message, and she'll be happy to answer you, or you can message me, and I'll answer you, or perhaps Mandy or Johnny can help you after the service. Let us stand as we, I suggest we don't join hands. There is a flu going around now in the crowd, a head cold. So I suggest that only families join hands, just with your children, mum and dad and kids, or whatever your family's made up of, mum and daughter, whatever it is, brother and sister. But let's not hold hands with people not from our family at this time, until this flu is passed. Let us sing, may God's blessings surround you. We have a lovely time. Oh, and Crystal has moved, has retired from Cathay. She has her birthday on Tuesday, and she's retired. It's not because of COVID, it's because of permanent, it's because of compulsory retirement at a certain age. And that means she's moved out of her flat, and she's in the hotel waiting for the completion of her documents and so on, and she's going to be back every hour, any minute now. So that's great news. Please keep her in prayers. I think it's a bit sad, you know. You finish with a company after 30 years. It's a time of grieving for her, and leaving her home in Hong Kong, really moving to Macau full time. It's a big step in her life, so please keep her in your prayers. Let us sing together, may God's blessings surround you. Saturday. Oh, I've known you here. words were ringing in my ears, so I thought, well, I better rise to the occasion. You know, I spoke to you recently that sometime, of course, I don't want to do it in a way that endangers your health. I don't want to do that, so I brought my mask, and I'll keep my distance. I won't hug anyone or get close to anyone. Don't get too close to anything. Thank you for doing that. That's lovely. You've got a new light. Beautiful. Yeah, you have to actually cut candles back. You've got to cut back the wax so that the wick sticks up, otherwise they drown in their own wax. Okay, so in your bulletin today, I think it's on page 16, you have a sermon outline. So I'd like to invite you to turn to the bulletin, please, and to the sermon outline. If you don't have a pen, you might need a pen, maybe even a Bible. Does anybody need a pen? Yeah, there's a few pens needed. Thank you, Miss Lottie. Okay. I was thinking that as we approach the church camp, the topic of the church camp is prayer ministry. Prayer ministry means praying for others. Ministry is any kind of service that we do in the name of Christ for one another. When we feed the hungry, it's ministry. When we sing in the worship team, it may be ministry to God, hopefully ministry to the congregation, if we sing in tune. If we serve on the PA team, it's a ministry. It's a word English that we use to mean any kind of service to God and to other people in God's name, you could say. So we're going to be talking about prayer ministry, which is a particular kind of ministry. On camp, prayer ministry is that ministry where we may share our prayer needs with one another, and we may pray for one another. Very often this is done with the laying of hands. Excuse me. But not always with the laying of hands, but sometimes. Sometimes it's done with anointing with oil. According to the teaching in the letter of James, it says, if someone is sick, call the elders of the church and let them anoint them with oil for healing, and the prayer of faith will save the sick man. So we sometimes anoint. I have oil here every Sunday. If you ever want to be anointed for healing or blessing, you can do that any Sunday. And in fact, any of you can do that for one another. You can take the oil here, don't take it out of the room, but just here on Sunday you can anoint and pray for one another. So this is prayer ministry. Prayer ministry could include how to lead someone to Christ. If you have someone who's saying, well, actually, I want to follow Jesus. When you do that, you panic, you know, call a priest. Or how do you pray for someone to be filled with the Holy Spirit or receive the gift of the Holy Spirit? Or how do you pray for someone who is sick? So we're going to be talking about that on camp. And we'll be laying down some theology and some principles and practices of how to do that as a congregation. But in order to do that, we need to really be clear about who the ministers are. And so today's sermon is an introduction to camp. I'm beginning to build up to camp. If you know any Sunday school teachers, you might want to tell them that they should get the tape of today's sermon and listen to it. Are we taping it? Isla, are we taping the sermon? Does anyone know? Anyone on the PA team? Is Matt here? No? Do we tape the sermon anymore? I'm not sure. We used to. No, we're not. Okay, because it's on the video, isn't it? Okay, so they can watch it on the video. All right, no worries. Thanks, Leo. I haven't clicked that stop now because we're doing video, but that makes sense. You don't need to record it, do we? Although, now we don't have the mic here, the mic that I normally have here, the external mic is broken for some reason, so hopefully it'll pick up okay. So, who are the ministers, actually? If we're going to practice prayer ministry, we need to be clear whether we are authorized to do so. Well, the question of who are the ministers is actually begs another question, which is who are we? Who are you? You know, you might presume to do something. Let's say you offer a friend medical advice, and your friend is not happy about it. Your friend might say, who are you to offer me medical advice? You haven't been to medical school. You haven't been trained as a doctor. You know, why do you presume? Of course, that would be kind of rude to confront somebody with knowledge, just ignore them and walk away. But what if someone was to give you advice about your children? I remember once I was talking to a Chinese mother in Sha Tin in Hong Kong, and she was concerned about the future of her children, and she asked my advice about whether she should send her children to an English-speaking school or a Chinese-speaking school. And no one had ever asked me that as a pastor before, but I thought it was an interesting question. And I was a great supporter of the English-speaking schools, the ESF School Foundation. We had lots of kids and families that went there. But I ventured my answer, my opinion. She asked me, I said, well, to be honest, if I was Chinese-speaking and I had a child, I would send her to a good Chinese-speaking school. Because I said, your children growing up in Hong Kong, if they don't become fluent in Cantonese and to read and write Cantonese, it will be difficult for them to function in Hong Kong as local people. If they don't have good Chinese-based foundation. And so I said, if it was me, I would send my kids to a Chinese-speaking school, Chinese medium of education. And I realize that that's a complicated issue. Of course, you have English-speaking schools that have excellent Cantonese curriculum, and that may be fine. But my concern was that I could see kids that were growing up in the ESF system who were not proficient in Cantonese, and when they become young adults, it's very difficult for them to function. And now the plan was that they would go to the University of Britain or Australia or somewhere and come back to Hong Kong, in a sense, as expats. But in fact, that's difficult because it means that they can only function in Hong Kong as expats, and they're not really fluent in their own language and culture, in their own language. Anyway, the woman asked me, okay, so I told her what I thought. And she was very appreciative. And an American missionary lady had been eavesdropping on our private conversation, wheeled around and very aggressively attacked me and said to me literally, how dare you give advice to parents about how to educate their children? You're not even a father. You don't even have children yourself. How dare you? I give advice to this woman. I was like, oh, sorry. You know, the lady asked me, so I said what I thought. She really did. She asked me. In fact, it was interesting what happened. That lady, actually, her husband left her, and she and the children were broken and emotionally, and we gave them a lot of support. And in the end, they emigrated to England, and the children went to school in England, and they grew up, and they're all professionals. They became doctors and architects and a lawyer or something, and they are, in fact, functioning as expats in Hong Kong now. And they're also pretty fluent in Chinese, so I don't know if I was right or wrong, I'm probably wrong. But anyway, that's got nothing to do with it. The point of the story is that the woman said to me, you have no right to express an opinion because you're not an expert in that subject. That's not your identity, it's not who you are. You're not a parent, you're not an educator. You know, and this woman was a friend of mine, she was actually the head of the Sunday school. So it was a pretty scary moment. Anyway, there's lots more behind all that. But the point of the story is, you might give advice to somebody one day, and they might say, well, who are you to give me that advice? You haven't been through what I've been through. You haven't suffered the pain that I've suffered. And of course, that's very true. You know, if you haven't been through a midlife crisis, it's very difficult to give an old man advice who's going through a midlife crisis. You really don't know what it's like unless you've been through it. Or if you've been abandoned, it's really difficult to give advice to someone else because you may never have experienced that abandonment yourself. Or if you lost a loved one to murder, for example, if you had a friend who was shot, you may not really be able to qualify to give advice. So what qualifies us to be ministers? What qualifies us to presume that we can pray for people or lay hands on them? That's what I'm going to talk to you about today, about identity, who we are. In fact, identity is a big topic at the moment because we have the Olympics and we're all cheering for our country. And there's nothing like the Olympics to bring out people's nationalism, right? There's some countries, like my darling wife's country, which very seldom wins any medals. And so nobody really cares about the Olympics because they don't watch it, they don't follow it, because they know they're not likely to win any medals. This week we saw the wonderful story of Kirilin Diaz from the Philippines, who famously won the first gold medal for the Philippines, is that right? In weightlifting. Really fantastic news for her and for her country, I guess you could say. Certainly a great personal achievement for that lady. in the swimming from Hong Kong, I was like, wow, you know, that's really cool. I used to be in Hong Kong. I identify with that. And even having lived now on the border of China for 30 years, I almost feel patriotic for China. I'm like so happy, you know, that China is doing so well. And it's funny, like, you look at the medal tally, and some medal tallies America's on top, and some medal tallies China's on top. And it just depends whether you count the number of medals or the number of gold medals who is on top, right? And so if you're in America, the medal tally will put America on top. If you're in China, the medal tally will put China on top. Actually, most of the world, China's, I think it's gold medals that count, right? So China's winning in that regard. But Australia is a little peanut country. I mean, we have 30 million people. Australia is the peanut country of the world. It's a tiny little population on a huge, big, massive land with basically nobody everywhere. And, you know, we do really well in the Olympics because we're sporting men. Australians are nuts about sporting, and so we elect politicians who pour a fortune into sport. And so when the Olympics come around, everybody stops. Everybody watches the Olympics all day, every day for 2 weeks. And I have been deprived for 30 years. I've been here, and I've been in Hong Kong, we get almost nothing except a little bit on the evening news about the Olympics. But in Australia, people take 2 weeks off, and they just sit home and watch the Olympics because on the coverage, they constantly feed the Australian athletes. You know, when they go from the Australian volleyball team to the Australian hockey team to the Australian basketball team to the Australian, athletics performers and swimmers. So you see everything Australia, all about all the Australian medals. And of course here, if you turn on Jade, you get all of the Hong Kong and Chinese performers and runners and athletes and so on. So it's not really as satisfying. So I watched a little bit of Olympics this week, but not much, but it affirms our identity that we are Australian or Chinese or Hong Kong or confused like me where our national identity lies. And even when he then won the weightlifting, I was excited for my Filipino friends. It's like so exciting to see the Philippines win the gold medal. We have many ways that we measure our identity. It could be nationality. It could be gender or sex, however you define that these days. You could see yourself as a woman or a man or something else. You could define by your age, I'm an old person or I'm a youth or whatever it is. You could see your identity in terms of culture. I saw a documentary recently on TV that was describing a city called Dubrovnik in Croatia, which was, it was a war there 30 years ago between Yugoslavia and Croatia. And during the war, when this beautiful city of Dubrovnik, I think it's by the Adriatic, was being shelled, terrible tragedy, the people of Dubrovnik emphasized their identity by doing something really interesting. You know what they did? In the middle of war, when they were being shelled, you know what they did? They secretly got together and danced. They had dancing. They secretly got together, they would text each other, and they would arrange secret rendezvous with large numbers of people in basements and so on, and they would get together and dance their cultural dances. Because in the face of war and invasion, one thing that they could do was affirm who they were culturally. It's like Filipino friends who come all over the world, and wherever they go, they dance their dance, and they play their drums and their gongs, and they affirm their tribal identity. That's what the people did during the war in Yugoslavia. Instead of, maybe fighting and throwing bombs back, they got together and they danced. And it was a way to preserve their sanity and their cultural identity and say, this is who we are, this is our roots. Some of us define our identity by our profession. I'm a lawyer, I'm a doctor, I'm a teacher, I'm a technician, I'm an expert in this, I'm an expert in that. Or I'm a mother, a homemaker, or whatever it is, or a father, a homemaker. Some of us define our identity in terms of our income or our social position. We feel that perhaps we are not important because our income is low or our social influence is weak. Of course, that's not true, but we may feel that way. And finally, we may even define our identity through our personality or our preferences. I like blue, or I like apple pie, or I like ice cream, which is chocolate and not strawberry. Whatever it is, we have our identity. I like this music and not that music. We have many ways that we define who we are. And for many people, these identities are incredibly important. When I preach about this, people feel uncomfortable. Because I'm going to suggest to you today that none of these things are really very important. It's not really important whether you're a man or a woman. It's not really important whether you're Australian or Chinese or Filipino. Shock horror. It's not really important whether you're young or old. It's not really important whether you have a high income or a low income, whether you have lots of PhDs after your name, but not much temperature, or a lot of temperature, whatever. It's not really important. But there is something that is really important in the scripture for Christians, and that is that our identity is in Christ. Now, if you turn to your bulletin, is it page 16 that the outline is on? Is that correct? Yes. Turn to page 16, and you'll see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 blanks, all beginning with the letter S. In the New Testament, invariably, Christians were addressed with this word beginning with S. The author of the epistles, Peter and Paul and company, would write to the saints. Right, saints. It's one of the, as we're going to look at a couple of the great heresies of the church today. And one of the great heresies of the church is the idea that saints are especially holy people who have achieved some gold medal status in being Christians. Saint Augustine, Saint Joseph, Saint Mary, I don't know, Saint Patrick, we speak of the great saints of the Christian life. But the New Testament knows no such saints. In the Anglican Communion, we honor our great Anglican saints. Desmond Tutu. No, he's not one. Is he? No, no. Not Desmond Tutu. Yes, Desmond Tutu, the Archbishop of South Africa, who played such a saintly role in the undoing of the apartheid system in South Africa, joining together all the sides and leading the inquiries there into the abuses that had happened. Desmond Tutu. Janani Luwum, the Archbishop of Uganda, who was killed by Idi Amin Dada. And many, many others. Many great Anglican Christians, people like me, celebrated this week the man who presided over the undoing of slavery in the British Parliament. I'm going to flu brain fog. What was his name? But the parliamentarian who brought in the legislation to end slavery. Wilberforce, thank you, my dear. No. William Wilberforce, we remember him this week as an Anglican saint. And we think of saints in this way, but the New Testament does no such saints. The only saints that are in the New Testament are the saints who are sitting around you, the Christians. Have a look at the Bible verses there on page 16. Romans, to all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints. Corinthians, to the church of God in Corinth, to those saints in Christ Jesus. 2 Corinthians, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the church of God in Corinth, together with all the saints throughout Achaia. To the Ephesians, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to the saints in Ephesus, the faithful in Christ Jesus. Philippians, Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers, that means the bishops, literally, and deacons. To the Colossians, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother, to the holy and faithful brothers. Holy means sanctified, all the saints. And then Romans 16, Greek philologos. Philo means lover of, logos is the word. Greek, the lover of the word, might have been a pseudonym, secret name, or maybe his name was really philologos. Julia and Nereus and his sister at Olympus, and all the saints with them. So we are reminded again and again in the scripture that we are the saints. Now, what does it mean to be a saint? Does it mean you're really, really two shoes, super good and perfect? No, of course not. A holy thing is an ordinary thing that we use for God's purpose. So, for example, the way I explain it to kids in the baptism class is I say, can I take that silver communion cup home and can I have my Coke Cola in it? And they say, oh, no, you can't do that. And I say, well, why not? I'm the pastor, it's a cup. I could wash it and bring it back next Sunday, no one would know. Why do I not do that? Oh, you can't, it's a special, it's the church. Yes, it's holy. It's only set apart for the purpose of communion. But here's the thing, the guitars are also holy. The cross is also holy. And you are holy because our lives are set apart for the service of God. And if I was to use a styrofoam cup every Sunday, it would be a holy cup. And I would not take it home and have my tea in it, because it would be the cup for communion, even if it was a styrofoam cup or a clay cup. It would still be the cup for the blood of Christ. I would not use it for something else. So a holy thing is an ordinary thing. Now, some of us might look beautiful, like that silver cup, and some of us might look ordinary, like a clay cup, or a polystyrene cup, or a plastic cup. But we are all cups that are set aside for God's purpose and for God's use. And that's what makes us holy. It's not that we're special or shiny or bright or more good or more righteous than others. Saints are ordinary people that God can use for his purpose. I want to focus today on a verse from 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 to 10. In 2 Peter, Peter writes, "We are the saints of the living stones who are built into a spiritual house, a spiritual priesthood offering our sacrifices to God." Okay. But in 1 Peter 2, 9, this is a key verse today, Peter writes, "But you, are a chosen people." Turn to your neighbor and say, "You're chosen." Say it with authority. Point your finger in their face. Say it like a minion. Look at them and say, "You're chosen." You can't do it, can you? It's difficult, it's embarrassing. You're chosen, guys. You're a chosen people. You are royal. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Good morning, Your Majesty." You're royal. You are the priesthood. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Good morning, Reverend." Come on. Say, "Good morning, Reverend Dixon." "Good morning, Reverend Dong." You are chosen. You are royal. You are the priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are a people belonging to God. That you may declare the praises of Him who brought you out of darkness into His marvelous light. One Archbishop of Canterbury once described the church as a ragtag band of saints and sinners. I like Peter's version better. Let's break that down. Number one, you are chosen. Fill me in the blanks. You are a chosen people. We're on page 17. In Exodus 19, we read that Israel was chosen by God. God said to Abraham, "If you obey me fully," sorry, to Israel, "If you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all the nations you will be my treasured possession, although the whole of earth is mine." So God has a favorite, and it's Israel. In Deuteronomy, "For you are a people holy to the Lord." That means set apart to God. By the way, when it says God is holy, it doesn't mean he's an ordinary God set apart for our service. What does it mean when it says God is holy? It means he is set apart from us. He is other than us. He is beyond us, above us, better than us, greater than us, in a realm which we cannot conceive of. So when it says we are holy, it means we are set apart for a purpose. We are dedicated. But when it says God is holy, it's different. It means that he is other than our condition, other than us, above us, greater than us, better than us. Maybe that's where we get the idea of holy. We think that when we say, "Oh, this person is really holy," we're using the definition for God. But actually, it's a misuse. Only God is good, Jesus said. Only God is good. When we speak of one another being holy, how we are saints, then that's the other holy, which means ordinary, but used by God. Okay, so you are a chosen people. But the situation of choice now applies to the church. In the new covenant, it's the followers of Jesus who are the chosen people. So Paul writes in Ephesus, "For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight." Now, does that mean that you're always righteous? No. Your blamelessness comes from the righteousness of Christ, which is won for you on the cross. Your blamelessness means that you have the righteousness of Jesus attributed to you because you're baptized into Christ. So you receive the gift of forgiveness of sins. So you have the righteousness of God. Now, this is not an afterthought. You are not chosen secondarily to the race of Israel. You are chosen from before the foundation, the creation of the world, to be holy and blameless in his sight. So God has called you from even before he has known you, and called you and chosen you from even before you were created. And this is one of the mysteries of Christian faith, that we believe that we choose God, but that we only can do that because he has already chosen us. And this is a conundrum. It's a contradiction. It's two laws that are opposite but both true. We call that antinomy. From antinomos. Two laws that are opposite but true. We are chosen, but we choose. It's a little bit like marriage. We are chosen. You know what is the old joke? He chases the woman until she catches him. You heard that? The man chases the woman until she catches him. That means that he thinks he's choosing, but actually she did the choosing. All right, number two, you're a royal priesthood. This is amazing. You're royal, Your Majesty. Good morning, Your Majesty. When I was in Hong Kong, my old vicar journalist had a Nepalese Gurkha staff guard on the church staff who guarded the grounds and was retired from the Gurkhas. And he was a very sweet man. Whenever he would see my boss, the vicar of St. Andrews, he would bow from the waist like this. He would say, "Morning, sir!" It was so funny. And so we all, the staff, the clergy and the office staff, we all caught on to this. So whenever we saw our boss, John, we would all do the same. We would all bow from the waist and say, "Morning, sir!" Please don't do that to me. So I'll do it back to you. So it was like he was like royalty, you know, you would treat him like the king. Morning, sir. Well, you are the royal, but you're also the priesthood. So that begs the question of what is a priest? And we have a little aside here, we need to talk about what a priest is. In the Old Testament, the priests were the people, the men from the tribe called Levi, the tribe of Levi, the descendants of Levi. And if you were a male descendant of Levi, then you were part of the priestly family. And it was a genetically inherited identity, and you had a role to offer sacrifice in the temple. And the sacrifice would be to expiate, to wipe out the sins of the nation. And you would also offer prayers, and the incense is a symbol of the prayers in the temple on behalf of the nation. So the priest in the Old Testament stood between the people and God to offer sacrifice and prayer to intercede for the nation. Excuse me. So in Greek and in Hebrew, you also, sorry, in Latin and in Greek, I'm sorry, as well as in the Jewish understanding, the meaning of the word priest is literally a bridge builder. In Latin, it's pontifex. Pons is the bridge and fex is to build. So pontifex is the bridge builder. And in Greek, it's hieres, I think, which means a bridge builder. So a priest is considered to be a bridge builder. So this is part of your identity. You are royal, which means you are from the family of the king. And you're also a priest, which means that you stand between God and the world. I'm talking about you, not me. You stand between God and the world. You bring God to a needy world. This is your identity. So you see how this now relates to ministry. When we learn to do ministry, to pray for other people, to lay hands on them, to intercede for them, we are standing between them and their sickness or their sin or their need or their problem or whatever it is, and we are interceding to God on their behalf. Or maybe we're sharing the gospel with them to lead them into a relationship with Christ. So you then are a bridge builder. You're standing between God and the world. So guys, this is your identity. You are royalty. And you are reverend. You are the royal priesthood. This idea takes its model from a very unknown character in the Old Testament in Genesis chapter 14. And his name was Melchizedek. And normally in the ancient world, people were either kings or priests. They weren't normally both. But in Genesis 14, you know, this chap pops up in the middle of the text. And his name is Melchizedek. When I was a kid, we had a mass that is a sung setting. So when we sang all the responses in the communion service, we would sing them instead of saying them. And it was called the Mass for Melchizedek, the King of Glory. And I don't know what the heck does that mean. Well, Melchizedek, the King of Glory, is this king of a city called Salem in the Middle East. But he was also the high priest. So he was king and and priest. And when you read in Genesis 14, that when he met Abraham, listen to this, he brought out bread and wine. Does that sound familiar? And he was the priest of El Eliona, that is God Most High. You remember the Amy Grant song we sing? El Eliona, Adonai, age to age, you're still the same, by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai. You understand El Eliona, Adonai. El Eliona means the mighty God, the God of the mountains, the mighty one. So he was the priest of Elion. In the Philippines, you talk about Kamunyan. This is Kamunyan. He's the creator of heaven and earth. He's Elion, the mighty one of the heavens. And so this, he was the priest of God. We're talking here like nearly 4,000 years ago. And this guy brings out bread and wine, and he blesses Abraham, and says, blessed be Abraham by God Most High Elion, creator of heaven and earth. So Melchizedek is a type of Christ. And in Hebrew, in the letter to the Hebrews, this guy is mentioned like 10 different times. And in every case, it's saying that Jesus is a priest like Melchizedek. But Jesus is royal, he's the King of Kings, and he's the high priest. And he brings out the bread and wine. In fact, he is the bread and wine. His body broken, his blood shed. So in Hebrews, Paul tells us Jesus fulfills another Old Testament meaning or image of Melchizedek, the royal priest. Now, you are the royal priesthood in the order of Melchizedek. Be that, okay? You are not only chosen, you are given, it's like you're a knight, but you're a knight commander of the British Empire. Except it's not the British Empire, it's the kingdom of God. You are like the knight commander, you are the royal priesthood, according to the order of Melchizedek, with Christ in the kingdom of God. It doesn't get better than that. Now, in the Catholic Church, there's this idea that the Catholic priest brings God down into the bread and wine, and it literally becomes the body and blood of Christ. So that's an incredibly powerful position, because the priest is necessary for your salvation. You need to take communion to be saved. And it's literally the belief by the Catholics to be the body and blood of Christ. And it's the priest who can do that, which makes the priest in the Catholic Church scary powerful, scary influential. Because by his identity as a priest, he's the only one who can stand between the people and God. But I believe this is not the New Testament understanding of the royal priesthood. In the New Testament, I believe, the royal priesthood are not people with a special power to bring God down in the Eucharist. When I celebrate the Eucharist, I am not the celebrant. We all are. You are all celebrants of the Eucharist. That's why I've been asking the assistants to come and stand with me during the Eucharistic prayer, which everyone knows to do. No one does it, right? So you did it once. But I've been asking people to stand with me because I want to communicate this understanding that we are all part of the royal priesthood. We all celebrate the Thanksgiving for the institution of the Lord's Supper. And my role is to preside. So I'm the president, not like Mr. Trump or Mr. What's the other guy, Biden. I'm the presider at the Eucharist. But you are all the royal priesthood. So it's not me making the magic happen. It's not me invoking the presence of the Holy Spirit in the bread and wine. It's all of us doing that together. That's the New Testament understanding, in my opinion. So, and this is the Protestant understanding, but I think it's the biblical understanding. We are the royal priesthood. We are the saints. We are the ones who make the bridge between God and the world, not a sacramental priesthood. In fact, in the New Testament, there is no priesthood in the New Testament except the priesthood of Jesus in which we share. He is high priest and victim, and we are the royal priesthood with him. Now, the bishop will call me priest, but that's actually a mistake. We speak of clergy and laity. Do you know in the Bible there's no clergy and laity? It's one of the greatest heresies of Christendom. One of the greatest heresies of Christendom, that there are clergy and laity. They say to me that Stephen, there are bishops and priests and deacons. Yes, but those are not different according to nature. They're different in function. So that your gift may be evangelism. Your gift may be hospitality. Your gift may be worship. My gift is pastoring and leading. The bishop is literally an overseer. So he is given a role of a ministry of oversight. But he's not, we are not different in nature to you. We are not these holy people who stand out there. I know it looks like it sometimes because we're wearing white dresses and so on. But actually it creates a false impression. There is no clergy and laity in the New Testament. There isn't. There is the clarity. And this arose from a verse, the misunderstanding. The idea that it was the professional clergy role to do the ministry came from a verse in our Bible reading today. Open your Bible reading to Ephesians chapter 4. And if you look, it's on page 3. And look down to the bottom paragraph there. And it says, it's talking about the gifts that God gave the church. And it says that he gave the second line of the last paragraph on page 3. Are you with me? Are you with me? Okay, second line, last paragraph, page 3. He gave some to be pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry. Now, in that sentence, who does the work of ministry? I'll read it again. He gave some to be pastors and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry. In that grammar, in that syntax, who does the work of ministry? The saints, it's really clear. And in fact, that's the understanding in the Greek. My job is to equip you to do the work of ministry. So it's not my job to do the ministry. You call me the minister mistakenly. I am not the minister. You are the ministers. My job is to equip you to be the ministers. That's my ministry. But there was a translation of the King James Version, I think it was particularly in a Bible called the Scofield Bible. It's very popular. And the translation was mistranslated. And it said, some were given pastors and teachers to equip the saints, comma, to do the work of ministry, comma, to build up the body of Christ. Now, in that sentence, who does the work of ministry? I'll say it again. So what it said was, some were pastors and teachers to equip the saints to do the work of ministry and to build up the body of Christ. Who does the work of ministry in that sentence? Sorry? No. Listen to it again. In the original, in this mistranslation, it said, some were pastors and teachers to equip the saints, comma, to do the work of ministry, comma, to build up the body of Christ.
Pastors and teachers.
And in fact, it's a mistranslation of the Greek. And that mistranslation impacted the whole of the English-speaking world for hundreds and hundreds of years. So for hundreds of years, you know, clergy would quote this as a proof text to say, my job is to do the ministry. I'm paid to do the ministry. Actually, it's not what Scripture said. The Scripture said that the clergy, the pastors and teachers, were to equip the saints to do the work of ministry. Not to equip the saints and to do the work of ministry and to build up the body of Christ. Do you understand the difference? It was a matter of a comma and punctuation and wording. And because of that, this heresy came into the Christian church, which said that it's the priest or the minister's role to do the ministry. And this imbued the world. So that today, I'm the clergy and you're the people. And I'm paid to be good and you're good for nothing. Sorry, it's an old bad joke. It's a terrible one, sorry. I apologize. Of course you're not good for nothing. You are the minister. It's a joke. It doesn't work in Chinese, really. You are the ministers. You are the royal priesthood. This is your identity. You know, I saw the video. When I'm doing communion, I'm so fixed on the person who's in front of me. I don't see what's going on around me. But recently, I watched the video. I always watch the video, but I watched through the communion. And there was someone next to me administering the bread and the blessing. And everybody was bypassing them and going to my line. Not everybody, but a lot of people wanted to be in my line. They wanted the bread from me. They wanted the blessing from me. Guys, that is so wrong. Today, I'm not going to give any bread or any blessing, partly because I'm a little bit fluey, but partly because it fits the sermon today. I want you guys to know that when Joe and Mandy get up, they're the royal priesthood. They're the ministers, just like you. And their blessing and their holiness is just as great as mine, probably greater. Because I'm paid to be good, and they're good for nothing.
minister to them for free. You know, that makes them more holy than me, right? Right? Yes. Yes. You are more holy than me. Because you're all serving in Sunday school and you're doing it for love. But I'm employed to be here. I also do it for love, but also I'm employed. You know, I can't get a spectrum now. Sorry. So you are the royal priesthood. Let's go on. You are the holy nation. You know, I don't care what you think about your nationalism and your how great your nation is and your national identity. You need to grasp this concept. National identity is an idol for Christians. You know, you say, I am this tribe, or I am that tribe, or, you know, I grew up, my ancestors are Scots. We've been in Australia for 100 years, but we're still singing Auld Lang Syne around the piano. You know, my sister still sings Celtic songs because we're Scots ancestry. We have that in our blood and our bones. But actually, it doesn't matter. Because in the kingdom of God, we have a prior national identity. And our national identity is not Portuguese or American or Australian or Filipino or wherever you come from. Our national identity is we are a holy nation of the kingdom of heaven. And that's the best passport to have, I believe. Don't ever put your ethnic identity above your Christian identity. Don't ever do that. It's an idol. It's a mistake. Number one, we are one in Christ. And that wipes out everything else. Paul says, there is neither male nor female, Jew nor Greek, slave nor free. Do you understand what a revolutionary thing that is for a rabbi to say? He's saying there is neither Jew nor Gentile in Christ. So I can say there is neither Filipino nor Australian. Doesn't exist. Not there. There is neither male nor female in Christ. We are one in Christ. We are one in Christ. This is not just a pretty sentiment. It means that it takes precedence. This is our identity as Christians. We are changed. We are not our own. We have entered a new kingdom. Welcome to the kingdom. Turn to your neighbor and say, welcome to the kingdom. You have a new passport. You have a new passport. You're not Vietnamese or Chinese or American or Australian anymore. The heck with that. You are in Christ in the kingdom of God. And that is an eternal passport that doesn't need renewal or wear out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You are finally a people filling in the blanks belonging to God. King James has a great translation. It says you are a peculiar people. I like that. When the youth group come in, I was a bit nervous at first. I really wanted to call them weirdos in an affectionate way. Hello, weirdos, how are you tonight? And I was a bit scared, you know, it's a rude to call them weirdos, or the teenagers, you know. So I was like, should I do that or not? And then I read this article that it defined the meaning of weird. And it said that the English word weird actually means spiritual or supernatural. So weird things, it's like Halloween, you know, weird things are like ghosts and magic and spiritual things, good or bad, whether they're good or bad, weird means supernatural. So actually, as Christians, by definition, we are supernatural. We have spiritual passport. So we are, by definition, weird. We are weirdos, good morning, weirdos. And that's what I want to say to you. I say to the youth group, hello, weirdos. They say, hello, Uncle Steve. Hello. And actually, King James Version calls us a peculiar people. Turn to your neighbor and say, you look very peculiar this morning. Peculiar means out of the ordinary. We are not of the natural, we are of the spiritual. So to wind this up and to close this off today, I want you to know who you are in Christ. That as we go through, Isaiah says, we are called the people I have formed for myself. But now this is what the Lord says. He who created you, O Jacob. He who formed you, O Israel. Fear not. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. You are mine. As the church, you are not, you know, Kalinga or Benguet. You are not American or Australian. You are not this or that. You are not Taiwanese or Chinese mainland. We are one in Christ. As the church, we are the unique, private, personal possession of God the Father. Filling in the blank.
chose us, become that. You can only do this as yourself. We are exalted above the nations, exalted to serve, saved to be servants. We are lifted up and saved to serve. We are guided like a flock. We've been talking about that a lot recently in the 25th Psalm. We are prepared for ministry to be erected by need. Don't waste a good job in clergy, do we? We are characterized by zeal. I love that. We are to be a zealous people and eager. We are to be eager leaders. You know, church would really be church. I know church is church when everybody comes 10 minutes early. I will not feel that I've succeeded as a pastor until the Sunday when everybody comes 10 minutes early. Because in the church, all around the world, it's not just us. Crystal, you know, from all over the world, she said, Stephen, every church I've ever been to, every country in the world, people all turn up 10 to 15 minutes late. And you know what? I really know that a church is church when people come 10 minutes early, because they're just eager, they're zealous to be with God's people, singing his praises in the courts of the Lord. That's to characterize us. We are to have the zeal of the Lord of hosts, to be eager to do what is good. Why are we given this identity? We are given this identity, we are called so that we can worship him. The Westminster Catechism asked the question, what is the chief purpose of humanity? And the answer was, the chief end of man is to worship God and glorify him forever. Our Catechism is a set of questions and answers that teaches us the faith. So the chief end of humanity is that we should worship God and glorify him forever. Peter puts it this way, you are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, and so forth, so that you should show forth the praise of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. This is why the worship, the singing, and the Sunday service is so important. Because this is what we're made for. We are rehearsing for eternity. We are made to sing, to dance, to praise, to worship God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength, to bring all that we are in his courts, to honor him, to thank him, to praise him. This is what we are made for. And then Peter goes on in 1 Peter and he says, once you were no people. Now this is a really interesting little phrase because it literally means little nothings. Once you were little nothing. Wow. I gotta say, once I was little nothing. Many times in my life I've tried to be little nothing again, and the Lord has very gently brought me back on his path. Once we were no people, but now you are the people of God. Once you have not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. And in Ephesians, remember that at that time, talking to the Gentiles, you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, foreigners to the covenants of promise, without hope and without God in the world. Guys, that's a description of your non-Christian friends and family. According to the Christian understanding, if we are outside of Christ, we are excluded, separated from Christ, from God, excluded from the citizenship of Israel, that is in God's people. Foreigners to the covenant of the promise, God's blessing, relationship with God, without hope and without God in the world. That's why we need to do evangelism. That's why we need to bring people to hear the gospel. Because we are priests. We stand between the lost world and God, and we seek to introduce them to the King of Love, the royal priest, who was both priest and victim, the royal priest who gave his life on the cross for their salvation. Now Peter says, you are God's people, the saints, the ministers, the royal priesthood. God has said, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? And the answer, the implied answer, of course, is man can kill me, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if I die, because I am the Lord's. Whether I live or die, Paul says, I belong to the Lord. What can man do to me? All I can do is kill me. It doesn't matter, because I belong to the Lord. Guys, I want you this morning to grasp hold of your identities. I draw to a close. And understand who you are in Christ. You are the ministers. Make no mistake. There is no clergy. There are no clergy. Bishops may come and go. Priests may process around and wear crosses and pomp and circumstance. There are no clergy. You are the clergy. There's no clergy in people, clergy in laity. There There's just a clarity. We're all in this together. That's the most profound theological statement of the 21st century. We're all in this together. It redresses one of the great heresies of Christendom. It suggests that somehow we are ontologically different. We're somehow different in being. Ontologically means being. My being is better or holy than yours. No. Probably it's less holy than yours, I would guess. We are one. We are all serving God. This is, I believe, the biblical understanding. I believe this is the Christian understanding of our identity in Christ. Let us, after our prayers today, let us just bow our heads and take a moment. Let us sink in. You're a chosen race, a chosen people. You are the royal priests, the royal priesthood. You are the holy nation. You are God's own people. Why? To worship you, to bring you glory, to serve you, to serve the world as he did. Lord, we just ask as we pray this morning that you would let this truth sink deep into our soul. Help us to realize afresh this is our identity. But as we go into this church weekend in a couple of weeks, we do so with this confident understanding. We are sons and daughters of the King of Kings. Now, friends, I want you to now, in the next 3 minutes, exercise your ministry of priesthood where you stand between God and the world by just taking 3 minutes of silent prayer to intercede for some friends that you know who are lost or in need. So a good shepherd, a priest, looks for the lost or the needy, cares for them. One of the ways we can do that is in prayer. So let's just take 3 minutes of silent prayer, and I just invite you to exercise the priesthood, to stand between your friends and family who are lost or in need, and to intercede for them to the throne of heaven. Got it? Okay, let's do that. 3 minutes. say, "Good morning, Your Majesty." You can then say, "Morning, sir." Or you could say, "Hello, Reverend." And all of those things would be true for us as Christians. Let us stand as we affirm our faith in the words of the Lord. With the church throughout the world, we declare together, by the way, can we let the Sunday school know that so they can come and ready? We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God of God, light of light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, by the power of the Holy Spirit, was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and he became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will come no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge John Baptist for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Amen.
Let us just go back to that reminder there of the two great commandments. The Pharisee asked Jesus a question to test him, "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment, the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Bearing in mind the two commandments, we confess our sin together as we say, "Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive what we have been, and what we are, and your reward is shall be, that we may delight in your will and walk in your way.
Hear these words of absolution and declaration of forgiveness. May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
We are the body of Christ.
The Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with the peace of Christ. As I mentioned, I won't come around, so please excuse me.
Oh, I'm in love with you.
Let us take them in remembrance
Let us feed on you in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. As usual, we do invite you, if you're baptized in any Christian tradition and you believe in Christ, you're welcome to receive communion today at the Lord's table. If you or your children are not baptized, you're welcome to come forward and just cross your hands on your chest as a sign that you're not baptized, and I will pray a blessing. Lord, John and Mandy will pray a blessing for you. Just to explain again, I will not be distributing the bread and wine today, as I will be under the weather.
Have anything to do later.
Oh,
she will have to.
Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food and the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you. Gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those who you love, now and forevermore. Amen. Let us sing our closing hymn, our Hallelujah, Sing to Jesus.
Enjoy the morning tea. Have a special morning tea this morning.